I'm nice to see all of you here for the third Sunday in Lent. Even though I know that most of you are here for the music today. Not only because Ray LaMonica is going to be singing Swing Low Sweet Chariot for us, which is a special treat, but also because it's the last Sunday of Kyle Carmo's music ministry with us today. So a very special day for the music at Aldersgate. We're so grateful to the 2.5 years that Kaya has been able to spend with us ministering in music. We're going to have a special recognition for Kim at the end of the service. And I also want to acknowledge Daniel Schinnebarger, who is a candidate for the music director position, who's here singing lead vocals this morning. So welcome to Daniel. You can get to meet him after the service. We begin our worship service praying together. We've shared joys and concerns during the week through email or you've read that Jesus with us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It's time for the children to come forward. After the special music, guys, I'm so sorry. If you want to sit in the front row, you can. Why don't you sit in the front row? First, we're going to have special music.
No. Yeah. Raise your
hand.
Let's give it a blast.
Thank you.
Because you know that we're reading through the whole Bible in the whole year, right?
Yeah.
And we've been talking a lot about kings and prophets and things that happened before Jesus came. Mostly, well, we did talk about one queen named Vashti, that's right, and Esther. That's right, mostly kings, though. But now we're getting to the part when Jesus comes. And so we're going to read about when Jesus was born, but it's not even Christmas. Isn't that kind of funny? Usually we talk about that at Christmas time. But let's hear about Jesus coming. Baby Jesus. One day, an angel came to a girl named Mary. The angel said, God has chosen you to have a special baby. He will be God's son. He will save all people from their sins. His name will be Jesus. I will do what God wants, Mary said. Many months later, Mary and her husband, Joseph, traveled to a town called Bethlehem. The town was crowded with people and all the inns were full. There was no place to spend the night except a stable where animals were kept. It didn't have a bed, so Mary lay down in the hay near the cows and sheep. That night, Jesus was born. Nearby, shepherds were watching their flocks in the fields. Suddenly, angels appeared, lighting up the night sky. The Son of God is born. Go see him, the angels shouted with joy. The shepherds went to see the baby Jesus. Everyone was so happy. The Son of God was born. God sent his Son to save all people. You can trust Jesus to help you, too. All right. So today you have Sunday school classrooms. Where's my yay?
Yay!
And I think you're going to do the next lesson. Most of you do the next lesson in the story after.
Yeah.
That's better. All right, very good. Let's pray.
Yeah.
Lord God, we thank you that you sent Jesus here as a baby so that he could live a life like ours and so he could show us how to live the way that you want us to live. We pray this in Jesus' name, and we ask a blessing and protection over our kids as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yay!
Thank you, Paul. All right. Oh, that's right. We changed the sides, and I'm so sorry. Oh, my goodness. All right. Our psalm this morning, Psalm 63, we're reading together verses 1 through 8. You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you. In a dry and parched land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. I cling to you. Your right hand upholds me. And now please hear the scripture lesson from the Gospel of John.
From the book of John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name is John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. the true light that gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which his own, which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children not born of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwellings among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is the word of the Lord.
Please pray with me. Lord God, we acknowledge before you that being here in this space, being able to sit still and quiet and to think about you is a very high privilege. God, we know that you're always with us, but we thank you for this special place that allows us to learn and to grow and to receive what we need from you so that we can be better disciples. God, we ask that you would have our minds and hearts open to this word, that you would allow me to think and to speak clearly. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. So, that scripture lesson, a little odd for this time of year? Yes? No?
Yes.
Maybe? Usually yes. We're like here with the lessons and carol service doing that scripture reading, right? That's a Christmas reading. I got a call about a week ago from Carolyn saying, you know, my mother was looking at the Sunday school curriculum for this coming Sunday, and it's some of the Christmas story. And that feels really weird to her. She doesn't want to preach on Christmas or to teach on Christmas. And in myself, I was thinking, my goodness, the incarnation is always relevant. I think that's just silly to feel like you can't teach about the incarnation just because it's not December. Harumph. And then I opened the book and read the scripture and thought, I can't preach on this in February. It's just weird. But it was so interesting to realize how much this text, the coming of Jesus, the birth of Jesus, is absolutely married to our cultural celebration of Jesus. The only time we talk about it in church, in the calendar of the cycle of readings, the lectionary, the only time it ever comes up is at Christmas. So preachers are never encouraged to preach this text any time but then. And we have Christmas trees with lights, and we have pine-scented, you know, boughs hanging around, and we have lovely gifts, and we're singing carols, and we're eating too much, and all of that stuff is wrapped up in this message of God coming to earth in human form. And so at first I didn't want to preach it, and I thought Alice is on to something, maybe we're going to jump ahead. But then I thought, no, how important is it then to try to pull away that huge layer of Christmas from the message of the incarnation? What an interesting thing to do. It has been very rewarding. So I thought to myself, no candy canes, you know, no 24-hour Christmas carols on the radio, no Christmas cookies. What does this mean to me? And I think that the best illustration comes from just what Deanna just read. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. God has moved in. I think what can help us understand this is the difference between dating and being married. The difference between dating and moving in together. So when you're dating, some people have to go right into the Wayback Machine for the dating, right? I understand that, so let's use our imaginations here. When you are dating, where are Joey and Nicole? They're dating. They would be such a nice example. They're so cute. Are they not cute? Joey and Nicole. Well, when you're dating, wow, I mean, you love to spend time with the person because you're not always spending time with the person, right? And it's so special. And so you say, oh, I'm getting to see my beloved today. And so you think, well, what will I wear? The natural next question, right? What will I wear? And how does my hair look? And should I bring them something? And what am I going to ask them about? And I wonder how this has been going. We think about what we're going to talk about. We plan it out. And maybe we're going like on an official date. And so now we're going to go to dinner over there. Or let's pick a movie. And what do they want for the movie? And we put so much intentionality into it. And when we get together with a person, we look sharp. Our shoes may be too tight, but we look good, right? Because we want to put our best foot forward. And we do that relationally, too. It's not just our appearance, but we're very interested in everything they have to say. And we just hang on every word, right? We're just really focused, really engaged. And we spend that time together. It's precious, hopefully wonderful. And then we go home. And then we get to kick off those shoes that are a little bit too tight. Let the belt out a little bit, maybe open up a bag of chips, turn on the move too, you know what I mean, scratch. Right? You can kind of relax and just be yourself. Right? As much as it was wonderful and fun, you were a little bit sort of on, you know, on stage for that. And now you can just go home and be yourself. That's what it's like when you're dating. When you're dating, and the person that you are with over dinner talks about, well, I have no idea how anybody could vote for Bernie, that socialist, blah, blah, blah. And you're like, oh, I'm so offended right now. You don't have to engage, right? Especially if you're early in a relationship. You can just say, oh, that's very nice. Oh, how interesting. Right? He's so handsome. But I'm not listening right now because I'm angry. But yeah, you know? And you can kind of step back emotionally, right? You don't have to really engage. You don't really have to take that seriously and say, like, what are you kidding me? Now let's talk more politics, right? Just step back from that conflict. There's no need to have to really wrestle with the person that you're dating if they challenge you in some sort of way. You have your own thoughts. They have their thoughts. It's fine because you're separate. When you're dating, you do consider the other person. You're probably thinking about them a lot. But you consider them most when you're deciding what you're going to do together. Do they like to go bowling? Do they like to go to Jordan's to watch the water go like this? Because if they do, they're a friend of mine, just so you know. We love that in my house, right? What do they like to do? And if they really love Thai food, you're going to say, sure. Like, I don't love spicy, but I'll go, right? Because you're considering them. But then the next day, when you're on your own, you're thinking, I'm going for McDonald's, because that's what I really like, right? Yeah. See, I just get to make a decision for myself. Yeah, you like to go for McDonald's, but yeah. Right, you just think, well, I want to do it just for myself. I'm like, yeah, right, because who's in charge here? Just me, right? So I think about myself. I don't have to consider the other person at all times, because you're dating. But when you get married, when you move in together, this starts to change. Because all of a sudden, that good foot forward, best foot forward thing, that a little bit distant thing, that I'm going to do what I want right now thing, starts to really become difficult because you are in the same house with the person. Now, again, way back machine, some of you remember what happened when you moved in with your spouse. Some of you remember the thing that you heard or saw that you were like, what? I did not know that I was getting into that. We discussed this at the marriage ministry last night. The marriage study just wrapped up last night. We had a dinner meeting, and I want to shout out again to Dante and Carolyn, who are not in the room, but what a great job they did. There were 10 of us that were involved in that class over about 8 weeks, and they had a passion for that, the two of them, and so they decided to share it with the church, and I love that. So we just wrapped up last night, and I said, look, topic of discussion, what did you learn that surprised you when you moved in with your spouse? And we had actually some funny stories and only one little fight. So it's pretty good. But like, so you learn, oh, wow, you know, they really squeeze the toothpaste tube in the middle, don't they? That is so obnoxious to me because I like to move in the bed. Or they leave the top off. Or they leave their socks next to the bed instead of putting the socks in the hamper, right? Or they never balance the checkbook. Never balance the checkbook. You start to learn these things. Does anyone have a good story about a surprise you learned when you moved in with your spouse? Yes, no one wants to get in trouble. See, now you're smart. I can talk about Sam because he's out of the room, but I actually asked his permission. So don't go with other stories on me. I asked him last night. But when Sam and I first lived together, we lived in a two-room apartment. It was like a large living room with a sort of kitchen that you just walked in. There was no door. And then a bedroom. That was it. It was small. It was like a quarter of the size of this space. That's good because we didn't have any furniture, so it fit perfectly. And I remember with the laundry, you went out the door just down the hall a little bit. On the left was the laundry. So it was close and you didn't have to go up or downstairs, but it was far enough that you couldn't hear the machines. And I remember like a month into this thing, Sam's looking at his watch, and all of a sudden he's like, oh, wash is done. And he hops up and he runs down to the laundry room. And I thought, did you just time the washing machine? Like, do you know how, he's like, yes, 32 minutes. I was like, oh my God, I married my father. Right, I didn't know that. And so just to be fair, I say to Sam, so what surprised you about me when we got married? He said, gosh, I just didn't expect that you would never stop working. Like, I always am working. And you're laughing because you know that I'm about to say that he said, oh my God, I just married her father. We both married my dad. I know, right? But these are things you don't know until you move in together. This is the incarnation. This is what God has done. Is that God has moved in with us. Instead of being a God that Moses finds way up on a mountain, and only he can go up to and talk to, and then come back down to the regular folk. Instead of being a God that has an appearance through an angel, instead of a God who is unpredictable and has earthquakes or floods or things like this, suddenly, God has now come to be with us, to move into it, move from the dating to a marriage. You see this? God has moved in. God moved in to be with us because God wanted to know what it's like to live a human life. Maybe the one thing that God didn't know at that time, even though he created us. Why are these people acting this way? God is saying, I want to send myself to the people so that I can feel their struggle. I can understand what it's like to live in the flesh. So that I can understand why people leave their socks in the middle of the floor, or they squeeze the toothpaste in the wrong place, right? So I can understand these fleshly tendencies. In fact, we see that in the temptations of Jesus right before he goes into ministry. Jesus is being tempted by the things that tempt all of us. You remember that he fasted for 40 days. He knew what it was like to feel hungry. God had never felt hungry before until Jesus was out in the desert feeling hungry. And so he knew how irritable and how irrational and upset and nasty you can get when your body hurts. Because Jesus experienced that. And God knew what it was like to feel the tug of the lure of earthly power. He said, you know, I will give you all of these kingdoms. And the devil said when he was tempting Jesus, I will give you all of this if you just bow down to me. You will be the ruler of everything if you bow down to me. And the tug, how alluring. How compelling it is to say, oh yes, worldly success and worldly power is so attractive. And God's just over here. And to feel that tug of war inside yourself. God wanted to know what that felt like. And so he moved in with us. But we also have invited God to move in with us. Not in the incarnation. But after Jesus lived that model life for us. And after he died and was buried and was resurrected and walked among the people, he gave the gift of the Spirit. The same Spirit that was empowering his ministry, he said, this can come and live in you. You're going to have the power I have in you. In fact, we're told later in the New Testament, your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. It's where the Holy Spirit resides, inside you. That's what happens when we become believers in Jesus, is we receive the Holy Spirit. God moves in. And so when that happens, things change in our relationship. Whereas before, when you're dating and you can do that best foot forward thing, I would submit to you that perhaps Israel had that luxury because they would go to the temple, the place where God resides, and they would make their sacrifices and pray, and then they would go home and relax. They went to God, they went away from God. It also reminds me of Sunday morning Christians that still exist today, not too much, but especially in generations past, where people would show up at church only in their very best, would never have a fight there at church. Everything is wonderful in my marriage and my family. How are you? I'm giving money to the Lord today. I'm so good. And then you go home and you do whatever you want because you're just getting your ticket punched on Sunday morning. That's a dating relationship with God. That's not God residing in you. When you invite God in, there is no difference between you right here and when you are at home on Monday morning or in front of that TV scratching with your chick. There is no difference because God resides inside of you. You don't have the luxury of putting your best foot forward over here and being away from God over there. So things start to change. When you're dating and you hear something that annoys you or challenges you or irritates you, you can just nod and smile and not really engage. But when God moves in and God starts to challenge you on something and say, actually, this is something you really got to work on. And I am bringing you to your knees right now in your life because you have got to address this. You can't just nod and smile and walk away from God. God is living in you. God is challenging you, saying, yes, you must engage. Just like you must engage with your spouse. When your spouse says, I can't stand Bernie or I can't stand Trump or whatever we're talking about, you're probably, maybe you walk away from each other on that one, but you do need to sort it out. You do need to stay engaged. You do need to wrestle and be challenged. That's what happens when God moves in. And finally, when you're dating, you consider the perspective of the other person when you're with them, and that's fine. Then you go home and go through McDonald's. Do what you want, right? Remember that? When God moves in with us, when we are married, our perspective starts to shift, doesn't it? We start to think with two brains, with two sets of eyes. And so if somebody says, hey, Rachel, do you and Sam want to go out to Mexico tomorrow night? And I think to myself, Sam really doesn't like my skin because it makes it so gassy. I'm going to say, you know, I love Mexican, but I'm thinking with two perspectives here, automatically. And I'm going to say, oh, can we try the new Chinese place? I'd love to go out with you. Let's try something different. But not for me, but because I know what my spouse is thinking. I'm looking at the world through two sets of eyes. You see, I have this different perspective that includes him at all times. And that's what happens when God moves in. Here, there's an opportunity. There's something you can do. Go over there or try this new thing or whatever it is. And you think, oh, I myself think that's kind of neat. But if God's moved in, automatically you're thinking, what is, does God have this for me? Like, is this the right thing for me and my relationship with God? And you take into consideration that perspective that God lives inside. So you start thinking with those two minds. The most beautiful thing is when you are dating someone, you date them and then you go home. When you are married to someone, you date them and then you go home and they're still there. Right? This is the neat thing. That our home becomes the place where our spouse is. Our home becomes the place where God is, because God lives inside of us, and that's just what a beautiful thing, what a humbling thing to think that God would come and move in to our lives in that way. So I'm wondering, some of you probably have a private room in your house that belongs to you, like an office or a man cave or a sewing room or something like that. Maybe some of you. You do. There you go. Okay, and so that's your own space, and you can close the door. I used to babysit for a family in high school who had a ton of money and built a house. That was good because they paid me well to babysit. I was able to buy a car from all that money. That's how much they paid. So I appreciate them. But they built a new house, and I remember the first time we went in. I went in to see it, and you walk in the main door, beautiful entryway, all this lovely wood and inlay, stuff like that, really pretty. And most of the house is off to the right. But to the left, there's a set of French doors. And that's just a little wing of the house, but you go into this French door room, and it is Tim's office. This is where he brings clients. And so you're coming into a sitting area, there's a couple sofas, there was a very nice TV there, built-in bookshelves, kind of in the receiving area, there was a desk, farther in the back. And he was real proud of it. I mean, he designed this house, you know, so he was like, oh, you got to see it, it's so cool. And he says, watch this, and he flips the switch, and all of a sudden, overhead fans up in the ceiling. Like, not these kind of fans, like a built-in fan, like in your bathroom, you know, the kind that's in the ceiling. And except it was the ceiling, it was like 12 feet high, by the way. But all these fans start up, and I said, oh. And he said, well, I like to smoke a cigar on occasion, and Marianne hates it. And so if I want to come and have a cigar in my own house, she would hate it if I did it over there, but I can come in, I can close the door, turn on my fan, and I can have a cigar. He had his own space. He had a private room. He had a place where he could close the door and say, you can't come here. This does not work in our relationship with God. This is not part of God moving in, saying, okay, God, everywhere except for this room. Because if you're like me, you've got one of those rooms. Even though I know, and I'm looking around, these are not Sunday morning Christians I'm looking about. I know that you're people who want to practice your faith just as much as you breathe, and you're a Christian on Monday and Tuesday too. I know that about you. But there's probably a room that you have in your house that you like to just close the door and say, well, God, not here. Like, turn off the switch. Maybe that's when you go out with the girls for a few drinks, right? The girls from college, and they're not Christians, and so, hey, let's toss a few back instead of one. Or maybe it's when you're on the internet, just noodling around, kind of seeing stuff. Maybe it's when you're scrolling through the channels. You're in your own private room. Maybe it's when you go to the voting booth and you say, God, in politics, all things, close the door, God. No. So I'm challenging you. And I'm here just as someone on a journey right with you. I think I've got it too. What is your room about? What do you hide? What do you close off? Because that is not what God has asked you to do. God has asked to move in. And that's what we've said when we've become Christians. God, move in. Move in. I want you in here. My body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. You are here with me. Awesome. So the incarnation can be thought of going from dating to marriage or dating to living together. We can't just put our best foot forward with God anymore. We can't disengage when we get challenged. We have to wrestle with it. We have to consider the perspective of the other person. And you know what is so cool about all of this? This just occurred to me this morning, and I love that God is just keeping on working on the sermon until 11:17 when it's over, just so that you know. But what is so cool about this is that what was God's plan from the very beginning? We've been reading through the story the whole Bible. We've been reading it chapter by chapter by chapter. And what God is trying to do is set aside a nation of people that can be ambassadors of God to the world, right? They can show the world what it's like when you live a life with God. That was his intention with Israel. And they tried, and they did okay, and then they did badly, and then whatever, right? Wasn't working out. And so God says, I'm going to now come to earth, I'm going to move in with you. But this is the really cool thing, is that we have moved from a relationship with God that we know about God because of external experiences to a relationship with God that we know about because of internal experiences. We have moved from receiving the word of God on stone tablets to having the law of God, the love of God, written on our heart. Written on our heart. And so if the words of God and the love of God is now inside of us, how does the world learn about God? By watching us. Guess who that nation of people that are meant to be ambassadors of God is? This is what God has still been doing. It's the same thing that God was trying to do from the very beginning. I need a nation of people to represent me to the world. Yeah, you're looking at it. We're looking at it. This is it. Because it resides in here. So God has moved in with us. God has become flesh. God with us. God incarnate. Have you invited God into your house? Because God wants to move in. Amen.
Amen.
It's now time for our offering. Let us pray. Lord God, we're humble and grateful that you love us enough, that you would come here and wrestle our wrestling matches, that you would work with us as imperfect as we are. We ask that you would help us to open the door to those rooms that we hide off from you. Please receive this offering, Lord, as our response to the great things you do in our life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Please do that. Coming up on Thursday night is the paint night here at the church. This is a fundraiser, just fun. This is for your friends to come in and be coached on how to do a painting and have a good time, and it's just very relaxed, very enjoyable. You can walk into that event, but if you are able to go to the church email that you got this week and sign up through the link, that will help JJ, our leader, know how much supplies to buy. So tell your friends, tell your walking group or your book club or whatever you have, and come to paint night on Thursday. Today's the last day if you are between 6th and 12th grade to sign up for the 30-hour famine. I am turning in our registration forms this afternoon to the youth director at Wilmington United Methodist Church. If you are interested, please talk to me and make sure you have filled out the sheet that indicates your preferences for your mission trips for the 30-hour famine. That is March 12th and 13th. And finally, next Sunday is Girl Scout Sunday, so we'll have a bunch of scouts helping us lead worship. If you have a Girl Scout, if you are a Girl Scout and want to participate, I need to know so I can give you a role. So please speak to me about that. It's time for celebration and thanks, and I think that Bob Kingsley is our man for that.
How about now? Well, here he is again. Yes, we're going to talk about that Tesla electric car. When we first heard about your departure, we instantly thought that you were disappointed about not getting that Tesla electric car that somebody promised you. I'm sorry to say that our campaign has not yet collected the $80,000 to pay for it. $84,000. He's looked into it already. Then we heard that you had accepted an offer from the Boston Symphony Orchestra using your talents on the weekend. We were delighted and agreed that your talents are that good. But I want to say just a few observations that I have had, and I think other people have too. You are reliable and dedicated, and I know Rachel appreciates that, because she doesn't need to worry about the music part of the Sunday services. It's something that you've taken care of completely. You've done a very good job at communicating with the church. Good business communication at all times. Your adaptability isn't limited to just music. You've guided our Sunday music program from a choir-driven program to a more contemporary program with a band. I find it really quite remarkable how well you have picked up Ray LaMonica's style. You two guys are marvelous, a marvelous duo, and should go on the road. You can play the traditional Christian hymns, and you can play all the contemporary music, United Methodist music that both Rachel and Carolyn have found and have asked you to play. And I wouldn't be surprised if you know how to play Mozart's Piano Concerto number 21. You have also offered leadership. I've heard some of the band members say some very nice things about your ability to guide and motivate the members. You are very sensitive to their needs. And I bet they have found it's just plain fun to work with you. I personally find your language skills very fascinating. Aside from your native language from Zambia, I believe you can turn on a serious Scottish Highlander brogue. Look, and you speak flawless standard American English. Amazing. You're a very genuine person and a very nice guy to work with. I'm sure that others will agree. These attributes will carry you a very long way. I also thank you for bringing your wife, Corrine, and your children, Haley and Isaiah. They are a delight when they come to visit. Thank you very much again. You will do very well in the years to come. God bless you, and we wish you the best. And I have a little something that the members wish to give to you.
on the screen, so we inscribe it to you.
I'm just going to say a few things. This is so hard. When I got the offer from the other place, the first thing I thought of was, oh Lord, thank you so much for this. And the second thing I thought to myself is, oh Lord, Aldersgate, you guys have become more than a family to me. I'm sorry, this is so hard. It's like whenever Isaiah, my little boy, does something wrong and he wants to do something and I can see it in his eye, he's being so naughty, and I tell him no. And then sometimes when he wants something so bad, he's crying, please daddy. And I say no because I know it's not good for him. Saying no to a kid that you love so much is probably the hardest thing you have to do. The second hardest thing, I think, is saying goodbye to the people that you love the most. But I'm not gonna say goodbye right now. I'm just gonna say till next time. I will come to visit very often, just down the road. You have brought a new dimension to my life. So I can't even put into words the feelings I have for every one of you here, especially the bands. You guys have become brothers and sisters to me, and I know that I'm leaving you guys in really good hands here. The young generation is just coming up, and it's just amazing the talent that's in this little corner here. And I just want to encourage each one of you to support these guys right here. Just give them every bit of support that they deserve. They will take this church to greater heights, and I believe that. And not only to put Aldersgate on the map, but also to put Jesus Christ on the map. They really shine Jesus' light through their music, and I just want to thank you guys for that. Thank you, Pastor Rachel. I know it was hard to read that letter that I wrote to you. It was even hard to write it. I think it took about 3 weeks just to draft that letter, and I kept changing it and changing it. It's like, I didn't want to do it, but it's something that had to be done. And thank you for everything that you've done for me, the support that you've given me. And to all of you, just thank you so much. I appreciate it.
I'd like to interrupt for just a second. I'm going to miss you riding with the keys. That there, when I go home, during the day, when I hear somebody play riding with the keys, I'll think of you. God bless you wherever you go.
Clearly, our celebration and our thanks today go to God for the gift of Kaya. Please stand for the benediction. May the God who has moved in with us, the God who we invite into our lives every day, every minute, every breath, every song, may that God be with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.